Welcome everyone to the February 1st meeting of the Hadley Select Board. First item on our agenda this evening is a consent agenda. What's included tonight is the minutes from January 25th. There are two warrants. We have a recommendation from the Police Department on surplus less than $500. We also have a recommendation from the Police Department for an employee evaluation policy. We have a one-day liquor license request from Wine and Canvas for February 11th, 2017. And we also have a notice of intent to retire from Mr. Stanley Sadlowski, one of our very, very, very longtime DPW employees. And just for information, his letter is indicating that it's his intent to retire at the end of, or towards the end of 2017. So we appreciate his notice and plan on working with him for another 11 months or so anyway.
Could I add a comment to that?
Sure.
Thank him. He actually does double duty. Mm-hmm. He's also a fireman, and that's one of the reason why he's retiring. He's going to reach the age of 65, and it's mandatory retirement for firemen. And he's done that as long as he's done the highway. He'd leave the highway position, go right to the fire department, jump in the fire truck, and go. He's done that for years, and he's been a real asset to the town of Hadley.
He's not going to be upset with you for divulging his age, is he?
Well, I don't think so.
Okay.
I hope not.
Motion accept.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded for the consent agenda.
Except for Stanley's resignation, because right. I work with him.
Okay, so so all in favor? Aye.
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 Okay. She's here for okay. Wine and Canvas.
Yeah.
So we just passed it. Okay. You're approved.
No, mm-hmm. No, this, no, this is different.
4-1. Oh, you're a different
yep.
one. Oh, here we go.
I've got two on.
Sorry
right.
about that.
Thank you, though.
Right. But that was a very nice segue, Joyce. So we do have another discussion related to the Wine and Canvas. So, and this is a local licensing authority. Request for a liquor license, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So, do you want to talk about that, or?
Where is this?
Yeah.
So, we have taken over the former Grand Round location at the Hampshire Mall. So we've completed phase one, and we've been working with you all for the one-day licenses to pour on Saturdays. And so now we're looking to elevate that to an annual license so that we can hold more frequent classes in that space. Mm-hmm. And with this expansion, we'll also be heading into the, so right now phase one has been the more interior room to the mall, and then this will allow us to actually rebuild the bar in the front space and have a pub area as
oh,
well.
Right. It's been a long time. I'm trying to remember how the pub was, Grand Round was
situated. Yeah, so right now we're in the former dining room.
Okay.
And then we're looking to be able to expand into the front.
Okay.
And restore
well,
the pub.
Well, you moved quickly from one den to the other.
We did.
Well,
yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, it's very exciting for us.
Yeah. A recommendation of the fire department? Police department?
Yeah. Do you have any? Yes, I do. She passed inspection from the building inspector and the fire chief. And Chief Mason says that he's been doing the one-day licenses for her for several months now. They've not had a single complaint or concern about them.
Motion accept.
Second.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion?
No.
No? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Good luck to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Great. We're excited for you. Thank you.
Thanks.
We have an appointment at 7:20, but he is not here yet. So maybe we can go right into, hang on.
You already passed over public comments. Did I miss that?
Oh, yeah, you're good point. I'm sorry. Is there anyone here? Is there anybody here for public comment this evening?
I could add,
Dan?
Not to add anything to your schedule, but something that town will probably deal with over the next few years because of the Route 9 widening project. An issue that I noticed as I'm working at the end of Mill Valley Road. That's a pretty dangerous intersection. I'm sure the Mike and Mike show have been there quite a few times for issues, but
you mean Route 9 and where?
Yep, and Mill Valley Road.
Yep.
As soon as you come onto that road off of Route 9, the first thing you see is a sign that says 45. And the next thing, there's a driveway for the place that I've been working on. And cars, I mean, I do it myself. You get on that road and you just go down and you don't think about the speed you're going.
Mm-hmm.
And no traffic has been using that driveway because there's no occupancy in that building yet, but soon there will be. and it will, you know, it's, you know, I don't want to see something bad happen there. I don't know if maybe he can look at that area with Marlo and see maybe lower the speed limit there or put the sign farther down or put some other signs say dangerous intersection.
I was just working there this week myself, and I was going to say something. You know, the police department are looking for a place to write some tickets. That road, they fly down that road because the pump station's just down the road.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, they got to be doing 50 or 60 by the time they get down to that first ditch. Okay. They are really flying.
How close is the driveway in proximity to Route 9?
The driveway is probably, you know, within 100, you know, 150 feet or so. The sign is even closer to Route 9 than the driveway, and it's just. And if the sign said 35, it would be a little more reasonable. But I'm not going to tell you to change the speed limit. To do something there to maybe put that sign farther back. I mean, you're not going to stop people from flying down that road.
And the other thing I wanted to bring up was maybe in the Route 9 widening project, if they could sweep that out to a 90 degree intersection like they're doing everywhere else instead of the jet out.
Yeah, I'm sure that, like I said, I'm sure we'll deal with that problem further on down the road just because it's going to happen, and I'm not really worried about that actually happening. I'm sure it will. But just to do something, you know, get the ball rolling, maybe, again, maybe Marlo could take a look at it and see if there's something.
There's been a
Jennifer,
ton of
accidents would you mind taking that as an action item for our DPW director? Mm-hmm. And maybe talk to the police chief as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else for public comment? Okay, if not, we have an appointment at 7:20, but our appointment has arrived. So would you like to go ahead, or are you expecting guests to come in and support you? Or?
No, I think I'm on my own.
You're on your own today?
John, you have a lot of support here today.
For good or for bad?
For good.
Okay. So we've invited our state representative John Seibeck here this evening to provide us with a legislative update, and also he's here for the opportunity to field any comments or questions that anybody may have as well. So thank you for taking time out of your schedule to join us.
Yeah, this is a crazy week. If you don't know the way the legislative process works, we had until last Friday to file bills. Actually, the week before. And so there's a total of about 6,000 bills that are filed in the House and Senate. So we now have 2 weeks up until 5 o'clock on Friday to co-sponsor. And as of right now, I've got 286 emails that are sitting. I had about 100 at 5 o'clock, so I've got another 186 since then saying, please co-sponsor this or do this. And so it's kind of a crazy time for us. But what I want to do is just, I'm coming around to all the communities in the district for a couple of reasons. One is to update you on some of the things that are going on. But also, I talked to David in terms of looking at, I've got an appointment on March the 2nd, I believe, with the chairman of Ways and Means to talk about budget priorities. So I'm looking specifically at other budget priorities, you know, relevant to have them. And you know, sometimes it's hit or miss. You know, those of you who have been around for a while, recall that we were fortunate to get money for the dike to the tune of, you know, several hundred thousand dollars. So sometimes things are big and sometimes things are small. And the issue is, what can I do in terms of representing you as a community? For me personally, we don't know what we've got in terms of committee assignments. So the last committee I chaired actually labor and workforce development. I may have that. I may get shifted to something else. If you didn't go or didn't hear at the MMA meeting, was it last weekend, I guess?
Two weekends ago.
The governor talked about the governor's budget, because he talked about that and then released his budget last week. So he's talking about $91 million increase in Chapter 70 for schools. What that amounts to is at least a $20 per pupil increase for all districts. He's also increasing unrestricted local aid for communities by about $40 million. And that $40 million is balanced exactly on what's been projected as 3.9% in terms of revenue growth. So the way the budget year starts, the administration finance from the governor's office meets with Ways and Means from the House and Senate they try to figure out what, and they bring all these experts in to try to figure out what do we expect in terms of growth during this fiscal year. And the numbers, I think, range from somewhere around 2.5%, 2.3%, up to about 5.6%. And so the after hearing the experts, they kind of agreed 3.9% what they're going to budget on. So we're anticipating an increase of 3%. And the question is, do you stay with that? So in this current fiscal year, the governor back in late fall cut $98 million from the budget because of revenues being down. He also did an early retirement, I guess, for certain employees. It wasn't really an early retirement, gave people an incentive. If you were eligible to retire, and you did retire by, I think it was the end of November, there was a cash payout, I think it was $10,000 or something. So he got about 900 people who decided to leave early. That prevented him from doing more cuts. What we're looking at now is we still have $98 million in cuts that haven't been restored yet. We're waiting for the December numbers to come in. So the fiscal year started below what was projected, which led him to do those sorts of things. Then what happened is revenues actually started picking up. So as of the end of November, we were back right on target. We're hoping that the December numbers are optimistic, and if so, both the Senate President, so your Senator, Senator Rosenberg, as well as the Speaker in the House, are saying we're ready to start restoring some of these cuts. They didn't have an impact directly on you as they did for some other communities. I mean, I represent Granby. The Granby veterans had $35,000 for a Veterans Memorial. They've been raising all this other money. They were depending on the $35,000, and that money was frozen. So the project stopped. As the revenue started coming in, they said, okay, we'll release the money. So we're still dealing with that sort of a scenario, but we expect that we're going to see things back to projections, and we'll be able to restore. So what I'm looking for you at some point over the next couple of weeks through David is ideas or thoughts of the things that you need, whether they are Hadley specific or things that really are important to you as a community in terms of budgets and what we need to go forward. And that's how I wind up representing you. The second piece I want to talk about is Department of Transportation, DOT, basically Mass Highway, the old Mass Highway. So the project out here that's essentially completed at this point, and I'm not sure people realize, I mean, that project amounted to, let me continue with the budget, I forgot. So besides the $40 million unrestricted local aid, he's also included $4 million for grants to community compact communities, of which Hadley's one. So that'll come out at some point. You'll be able to determine whether there's a project or things that you want to seek in terms of a share of that money. There's $2.8 million for local technical assistance to districts. And there's $2 million in a capital budget for capital compact, our community compact IT grants in terms of going forward. So the fact that you did this in 2015 is more than just having the lieutenant governor come and you sign a piece of paper. So he's actually trying to follow through, saying there's money that follows that commitment, and in essence, will be divvied out. So you're eligible for that. All right, so let's talk about the Route 9. So the project's essentially completed. The total cost of that was a
phase
little over.
Is completed.
Pardon?
Yeah. The phase is
this
completed.
Phase.
Yes,
right.
Sir.
So this phase was about $3.1 million. Other things that are under construction or being completed at this point, the bike path improvements are about $3.6 million for the entire bike path. There's a small amount of money for some signage related to the bike path, which you're getting, Hadley gets a few dollars. The important thing is that there are there are five projects on the tip going forward. And the one that's most significant, and the one I've been hearing from you about it, are sidewalks on Route 9. And I heard from seniors and persons with disabilities in terms of trying to get access, particularly, right from the Hadley Amherst line coming across. And so that project is about ready to go. It's funded for 2017. The total cost is about $1.2 million. They've completed the design. They're going to start advertising, I believe, in May. The only holdup at this point before they can advertise is they've got to get some property acquisitions from 21 property owners. They don't think it's a big deal. We're talking small swaths, but they've got to have that in place before they go. And so what's going to happen is on the south side of Route 9, sidewalks are going to extend all the way to and across South Maple Street, which are further than what we originally expected. We thought it was just going to go to the first mall, but it's actually going to cross South Maple Street. On the north side of Route 9, it's going to extend to and the intersection of Campus Plaza Road. So look at where the old Pizza Hut was.
Pizza Hut.
They're going to put push buttons for pedestrians to cross signals at South Maple Street. So you can cross, but it's only going to be for South Maple Street. It's not going to be to cross Route 9 at that point.
Mm-hmm.
There's no crosswalk across Route 9 there. They're going to do Westgate Drive across Westgate only. So again, there's no proposed access across Route 9 or Route 116. At Campus Plaza and Greenleaves Drive West, because Greenleaves is really the ones who are really pushing it, there's going to be a pedestrian crossing activated with a button across all four approaches, so you can cross Route 9 mm-hmm. and West. So those people will be able to cross to go to Stop and Shop.
Excellent.
They'll be able to now come to the mall. So what actually has happened, and they're also talking about they prepared a design that wasn't originally part of the project to cross Route 9 at the Hampshire Mall driveway to provide connections with Wendy's and the Holiday Inn Express, so you actually be able to cross Route 9 even further. So I think there's more to it than what was originally proposed. It's taken a little while longer, but you know, I think from talking, actually I went to the Triad luncheon a few weeks ago and talked to people, and I know that I've heard calls from a couple of residents who live over Greensleeves who are concerned about this. Their reaction is a positive one. They're actually getting more than what they'd hoped for in terms of expectation, and it's going to make this much more pedestrian friendly, so people aren't basically captives in their home, persons particularly with disabilities. Besides that project, there's a bridge replacement on Bay Road over the Fort River that's scheduled for 2020.
That's on the TIF, not on the temporary. Jesus,
somebody I thought we're going to need a defibrillator.
table at you, John. Did you come across that tonight?
No.
I did.
That's on the TIF.
I did. No. That's on
the TIF, not on the repair that's going on now.
That's on the TIF. That's on
the
TIF.
Full repair.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's on the TIF. All right. So let's talk about the bridge.
Yes.
Can your office do anything?
Let him finish.
I've heard from a number of residents in terms of what happened. You know, you got Jersey barriers. There's been no construction. It's a year that these Jersey barriers have been here. I can't figure out why as well. What I was told before I start, don't shoot the messenger, Joyce.
I would do that.
I would.
The issues that were raised, and what I was told was that the substructure had more damage than they expected, that they couldn't get to it, they said, because of high water last spring, which I didn't really see, but that's, you know, what I'm hearing. And the other question is, if you're not going to do the construction, you know, what's the weight of the Jersey barriers versus the weight of the vehicles? That's a valid point, with one exception. And the exception is that the Jersey barriers, I believe, have been successful in keeping high weight vehicles off that area. If the Jersey barriers were not there and we waited, I don't believe those high weight vehicles would have remained off the road. And we can debate whether it was necessary or not necessary. So I'm being told it's going to happen. It's happening this spring. I have called DOT several times, expressing the frustration on the part of people from Hadley. You know, I've heard from Alan. I've heard from a number of people in terms of concerns. There's no, from my view, no justification for why it's happened. And we have an accelerated bridge program. This seems to be a decelerated bridge as opposed to accelerated. And I just
we got another one up in North Hadley that they're supposed to be working.
Yeah.
Two of bike replacements.
Let's do one at a time.
This is the most important one because, you know, and I told District 2, they're going to need that when they do this next section of Route 9. You drive that road every day, you know? And my question is, do you have any power to fast track it like they did the one in South Hadley in the ditch where that backwater comes up from the Connecticut River
mm-hmm.
in Bachelor's Brook? They did that fairly quickly.
They did do that.
And that was a complete replacement.
Yep. No, it makes no sense to me to have done the rerouting and do what they did at the same time the construction here is going.
And, you know, the signage still isn't perfect for the big trucks to get around. Somebody not right. from town to get a 18-wheeler around.
No, I hear you. I made a couple of calls, and I'll continue to call. And what we're doing, in fact, my chief of staff called this afternoon. I was trying to get it up there before I came here tonight to see what the status is.
There was a meeting scheduled for yesterday and was canceled because of the inclement weather. It's just the nature of the beast with this project. But there was a meeting that was supposed to happen yesterday. We were told, and we had a meeting with them recently, and they said that they told us that the other side of the bridge was not as bad as one side, but it was bad as well. So the project went from half a bridge to a full bridge reconstruction. They needed to go back and get some more money. That's where the delay was coming. And this is just for the rehab,
That was confirmed to me later on that they didn't have the money in there. The money did get appropriated.
Yeah, because it was over $1 million for the repair, and they're in the engineering process for the total replacement now, supposedly, from your office, from Stan's office. So
what we were told when we were there a couple weeks ago was that the money has been appropriated. Yes. They're waiting for the spring to come, and yes. the first meeting was set up for today. And from the start to the finish, we should be up and running by July, is what our most recent conversation
that's,
is.
That's what I had been told.
Okay.
Part of the issue, you know, there are bridges and there are bridges. Okay, in East Hampton, for example, the bridge right down from the center of town heading toward Northampton.
In front of the DPW.
The question when that bridge was done is, you know, why are you closing this area and doing this detour? Why aren't you doing another bridge like they did, you know? Basically, they did the adjacent bridge. When you're driving to East Hampton, you can just go right across on Route 5 and just go across the temporary bridge. Why couldn't you do that? And a lot of it is depending upon, at least in the East Hampton situation, the bridge was sort of like, if you think about a ladder, that if you remove one side of the ladder, all the rungs fall. And that was the situation there, and they didn't have enough land to go and put the adjacent bridge.
That's the problem here. They don't
and
have easement on
problem
either
here.
Side of the bridge.
But the reality is...
No, the town owns one corner, and the other three corners are three different property owners that they don't have easements for.
I think the thing that bothers me most on it, too, is that they wouldn't even give an ambulance a pass on it. So, to me, I think that's a big safety issue for our residents that live out that way.
They did.
For Amherst ambulance to have to go that way and then come back around and go back out the other way, then, you know, it's just not, I just don't like it. I'm being honest with you. You know, I just don't think it was a good thing for them to do, not to at least let the ambulances, they're not that much bigger than whatever, to get a person across there for the amount of time that it would take, you know. I can see a fire truck, but we had a fire on Chemura Road.
Mm-hmm.
And that's out that way, and thank God our firefighters, they actually got there before South Hadley 2 District got there.
There was another one.
Go ahead, Doug.
I agree with Joy. She said what I was going to bring up myself, and I think it concerns you too because your constituents in Granby and Belchertown, it adds a half hour to their ambulance run to get to the Cooley Dickinson Hospital, and that really should be exempt.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
I mean, they're right in tractor trailers left and right for going over that bridge. For the last year, it's been closed. You know? And they've given us a letter in writing up to 11,000 pounds of emergency for our mini pumper truck and the rescue van. So you're only talking 2,000 pounds of an ambulance.
Okay, so... That's the story on the...
Well, the one thing that I would suggest is, you know, this is the first I've heard about the meeting that was scheduled. I mean, I'd be happy to if I can, attend meetings together with the town to make sure that we're being told the same thing and there's not, you know, two messages being given, one to me and one to you, and anything I can do in terms of advocating.
The public wants to know what's going on, too. It's not just us, you know.
I understand.
We're getting yelled at, and we're asking you, you know.
I'm pretty sure John knows what that feels like.
No, I agree, John. I, and And I think the best way to deal with it is for us to work together in terms of trying to make sure that
I've always thought that DOT thinks they're a sanctuary amongst themselves, that they just do what they do, and nobody can make them do anything differently.
The new regime is better than the old one, for sure.
I think there's one other thing that I would suggest, and I certainly talked to him, but, you know, I would also, you know, on issues that relate to state, you know, executive office issues, I'd certainly wind up calling Mike Knappick, who's running the governor's Western Mass office right now. Mike's always been approachable. I mean, he and I shared East Hampton, and I think sharing those concerns, if you're not getting satisfaction at the department level, certainly we'll get them to the governor's office as well. So I'm happy to do whatever I can do, but let's work together.
Okay. John, I'd be amiss if I didn't bring up the question about increasing wages for representatives or Senate.
I'm glad you did.
You know, I agree 100% with it. It hasn't been adjusted since 1982. I said that at the MMA convention with my other colleagues. I think the big problem, it's all tied in with judges, court officers, and that's where the price tag escalates way up, you know, and I guess there's no easy way to explain that to the public.
Let me tell you people say we shouldn't be voting on our pay raises, and I agree 100%. I think it's inappropriate for a legislator to vote on their salary. Okay, and I supported that in 1998 when there was a constitutional amendment to take us out of it. So since 1998, the base salary was set, and it adjusts either up or down based on, that's the other interesting thing. It's based on a criteria, and there's not one clear criteria. So I've been the state rep for 14 years. In 2003, I got elected, and there was a pay raise. And I took the pay raise and donated it to my three communities and split it between the Council on Aging, the Library, and the Conservation Commission in all three communities. So that was pay raise number one. There was a second pay raise and a third. So there have been three pay raises. I took two of them. Two consecutive two-year terms, Governor Patrick reduced our salary. So in 2015, our salary stayed the same. In 2013, it dropped. In 2011, it dropped. So up until this session, I was making less money than I was, you know, 6 years before. And people said, well, you ran for this job and you knew what the salary was, and you're absolutely right. The other interesting thing is this deals with the stipends, not with the base salary. So there are stipends, you know, I get a stipend as a chairman of a committee. And I can tell you that, you know, I thought, boy, this is great, I get extra money. I didn't realize that I have to spend that many, you know, more days in Boston, the amount of time. And I accept the responsibility, and I willingly take it. The stipend for chairmanships and the stipend for per diems, which is the amount of money that I get paid to drive back and forth to Boston, has not changed since 1998. The stipend for the Senate President and the Speaker has not changed since 1985. I have one constituent from South Hadley who said, you know, it's too big. And it's in fact far more than I get in terms of my increase in Social Security, what I get from cost of living increases from Hampshire County Retirement. So I sent her a spreadsheet and calculated. If we had done what was based on those two things, it would have been higher. There was an independent, now the other criticism we got was the people had no say in this, and we rushed it through and no one knew what was going to happen. In 2008, there was an independent commission that recommended a salary that was considerably higher than what they're going to get. They had public hearings, so people had a chance to weigh in. There was a second commission in 2014 that recommended higher. So we've actually reduced what was being proposed. I can't speak, Don, to the inclusion of the judges and the other individuals, other than the fact that what this is now doing is saying the salaries and the stipends for us, and I can just speak to the legislative piece, we will no longer be voting on these again. That they will go up and down, and they can go down based on cost of living or based on the economic information, number one. Number two, the legislative piece is being absorbed within the current budget, so it is not, because people said, well, geez, you're giving yourself pay raises when you had $98 million in cuts. The legislative line item is not being increased to accommodate this. So how does that happen? I get a position for the committee that I chair right now There's a lawyer, a general counsel for the committee that left in the spring, and I haven't filled a position. So I'm sitting on 9 months of a position that's not being filled. I'm sitting on a receptionist in my committee that only works 4 days a week and only works 8 months out of the year. And the rest of the time I get staff that fill in. So we have not filled positions by attrition. I've had some people that say, you know, I'm a sleazy politician and I should have never voted for this and they'll never vote for me again. And that's their prerogative. And I can accept that. And if somebody chooses not to vote for me again and I get replaced by someone else, that person will never have to vote on their pay raise again. And we'll deal with the issue. You know, so I you know, it could have been handled. Oh, things could always handled better. Why now? Because I don't have my assignment yet. If I got an assignment, somebody said, "Oh yeah, you voted for pay raise because you're gonna double your stipend or whatever it's gonna wind up being." So I'll defend the vote that I took. I think it was a reasonable vote. I think it's long overdue, and I'm glad you asked the question, because I'm glad people get a chance to, you know, this is my position, and I know that there are people in Hadley and the rest of my district that don't agree with me, and I respect that. And that's what this whole thing is about. It's a representative democracy. Mm-hmm. You know, if you don't like the job I'm doing, then vote me out of office. But I would hope that at the end of a two-year term, people would look at, you know, what have I done, and weigh everything. And some things you'll agree with, some things you won't agree with. But I can defend this vote, and I'll vote again tomorrow in terms of overriding the governor's veto.
See, what you just said, the average voter never hears that end of it.
Yeah, somehow it doesn't
make
the
paper. All they hear is the increase in a percentage.
Sure.
And that's what goes into their mind, you know, and I'm glad the people in Hadley at least can hear and understand what it comprises of, you know.
Yeah, I wonder if there's any person watching tonight who was gone either 17 years, no, it's actually 19 years, or 35 years without an increase. I just never heard of that. You know, and they should have done it years ago.
Just the Board of Selectmen.
That's right. That's right. I agree. That's true because when I became a selectman in 1991, the salary had been, I don't know how many years before that, it's still the same. So
the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's okay.
That's okay.
That's why we do it. It's more of a volunteer thing than a pay thing.
I agree.
But I wouldn't want your job for nothing, John, and thank you for what you do.
Well, you know, the last thing I should mention, the last thing is you know, people, there's one Boston reporter, and I don't want to say who he writes for, but he all seems to herald the news. you know, and he says, you know, we shouldn't be getting this per diem. We should not get paid to go to work. I agree with him. But according to the federal government and the IRS, my place of employment, my workplace, is my district. Mm-hmm. So when I go to Boston, I get paid mileage to go to Boston. And the mileage that I get is $60 a day. In 1998, based on the IRS mileage rate, I should have gotten $58.50 a day, so it was about the same. The IRS mileage rate today said I should be getting $97.20 a day. It hasn't changed. And you know, I'm not complaining. But I think, Don, you're right. People, you know, none of that stuff, you know, made the headlines.
Exactly.
And so I really appreciate the fact you asked the question.
So you guys are going to have to get on the prevailing wage sheet.
No.
Either that or you'll have to start eating at the senior center more often.
John, I got a question.
Sure.
Okay. Just a couple of other things while we have you. Could you provide an update on the Berkshire Gas situation? Mm. And then we also have request. Three of us at least were in attendance at the school committee meeting on Monday evening. And just curious as to your position on the Chapter 70 foundation formula. And
okay.
Then sounds like there's another question as well.
See, Don asked the easy questions, Molly. Why are you asking? No, Berkshire Gas, as you know, originally, and you were at the hearing in Greenfield. Originally, the legislative delegation sought to become interveners, and we're not specifically interveners any longer. We're getting information. We're participating in conference calls. I know the Berkshire Gas is working on a plan to short-term strategy and long-term strategy in terms of addressing the problems in terms of the shortage and the moratorium. We're continuing to meet with them and say, you know, frankly, we are looking for a faster response, sooner rather than later. they're working this out and are going to be sharing this with us and with FERC. I've not seen it, so I can't really comment on it. But I will tell you that the delegation remains united. I can also tell you that those 6,000 bills that have been filed, there are a number of bills that talk about gas, talking about pipelines. I have co-sponsored a number of bills saying that, that if a pipeline is to be built, that the ratepayers should not be burdened with the cost of paying for that pipeline, that there should not be a tariff or any sort of means to force them to pay for it. My frustration, frankly, and I've never hidden it, is I saw Columbia Gas being much more proactive in terms of trying to address the issue than Berkshire Gas was relative to the moratorium. Columbia, for example, was trying to get some of the other communities who had commitments in terms of gassing, or if we reduce the commitment to your community by 20%, let's say, and I look at four or five communities, we could take that excess capacity and allow the communities that are under moratorium to get it. I didn't see that from Berkshire Gas. I've also, and I know that there have been comments made relative to properties in the mall, for example, where a store would close and that another store was to move in and they were not permitted to connect, and was told by Berkshire Gas that is not true and that's not the case. And I've shared that. So if that's continuing to happen, I'd like to hear about it.
It is happening, right at Burger King. Burger King, right in the town, not in the mall, right at the Burger King. I can tell you that we've had a store that's been waiting to go in there, and they were told point blank, absolutely cannot, even though Burger King absolutely had gas going into it.
Right,
and I'll confirm or deny that with Timmy
talk,
tomorrow.
Let's talk more about that. I mean, the only example that they gave me was if, for example, a store is a clothing store,
okay,
mm-hmm, and that clothing store in the mall decides to be renovated and now become a restaurant, then you're looking at the restaurant using more gas. And so that's not an apples to apples or an even swap, but in the situation you described, then yeah, I want to take that back. If that's the case, I'd like to know about it and go right back.
And we also had the Ground Round and Buffalo Wild Wings closed, so they were both heavy.
I think he's pointing in the exact same facility. Yeah. I think is what he's talking about.
I understand, but I'm just saying. You know, I mean,
capacity.
If you look at the capacity for the mall as a whole,
you're absolutely right. My question is, if things are closing, so if I'm at 100% of capacity, mm-hmm, and people are now closing, then I should be down at 97, 96, or 95%. Mm-hmm. So what happens to that extra capacity, mm-hmm, and why is that capacity not being given? Mm-hmm. And you know, I've got no problem with coming up with a strategy or rules in terms of how you're going to allocate that capacity, whether you choose to do it on a first come first serve or somebody decides. But the fact of the matter is, there is less, you know, logic would say there's less gas being used. Where's that extra gas going?
So, you know, again, just from trying to,
yep,
keep pressing this issue, because you understand the impact it's having on development, which means revenue,
mm-hmm,
which means, you know, forcing our hand here in Hadley on a budget. You know, clearly we've badgered you. We've badgered Stan Rosenberg's office with this. We went to the DPU hearings. What else can we do?
Nothing until you see what Berkshire Gas is going to wind up submitting.
And where's the DPU pressuring them on a timeline?
They are scheduled to do it later this spring. I think we're looking somewhere around April or May in terms of their submission to FERC. My bias is FERC is not your friend. You know, I dealt with FERC relative to the licensing of the Holyoke Dam. I dealt with FERC when I owned property up in Roe relative to closing. So I don't see FERC as necessarily as a friend to the community. But I also think it's something that should perhaps also be raised to Congressman McGovern. Let's look at it from that perspective as well. And the way that a similar situation like this was addressed, similar in terms of pipeline location, not this particular example, was to rely on another federal agency, basically rely on the EPA. So
mm-hmm,
let's continue to talk. But we're having periodic conference calls. I missed the one on Friday because it was at another event. But I can tell you that Senator Rosenberg or his staff, Rep. Kulik, myself, I think Rep. Mark, are continuing to participate in these conference calls to find out what's going on. But things, this was the first call, I believe, maybe the second call, since the holidays. Mm-hmm. But let's continue to pursue it. And now I forget what your second.
I just want to add, we're fortunate because of our environment on Route 9, Texas Roadhouse came in, and they decided to assume the extra cost to put in propane. They also put in the gas lines. As soon as they could convert, they would. But it's been a godsend to them that you can't even get into the place. They're so busy because we don't have a real good steakhouse until they open. And so we're fortunate in that aspect because of the environment and the people that are in this area. But we're still losing out on quality restaurants.
You're fortunate. You're also fortunate in the unfortunate fact that there's a moratorium in Northampton with Columbia. I mean, the issue would become one of, when I look at a chain restaurant, for example, somebody coming in, possibilities coming anywhere, I'm not sure that it has to be in this particular location in the town of Hadley. Their demographics may say, it could be on the Amherst side of Route 9, it could be on the Northampton side of Route 9 or that area. But by virtue of the fact that all three communities are facing the same scenario in terms of the moratorium, I think it makes it a little bit easier to swallow. If one of those other two communities didn't have a moratorium, I think the impact would be far more significant.
More of a problematic area for us in our business district is the big box stores and Amazon. But I see today Walmart's fighting back. They're shipping free delivery now. So I think these big box stores are going to start fighting back, and because it's their salvation. If they don't, they're going to go out of business.
The second point was about the school. The one other thing is that Amazon, now that they have a physical presence in Massachusetts, is charging sales tax on every transaction.
Right.
I co-sponsored the legislation to require sales tax on all internet transactions. I don't think that somebody should go to Sam's, for example, to just pick a place and try on a pair of boots and decide, okay, now I know which pair of boots I want. I know exactly what size. Walk out of the store, go home, and just click and have it shipped from somewhere else. It's not fair to Sam's or any other brick and mortar store that you're basically exploiting those individuals and their staff time.
John, back to Berkshire Gas.
Yep.
This didn't just happen yesterday.
No.
Because for years, UMass had to shut down their big burners, gas, and go back to oil or coal because the residents on a cold winter day needed the gas. They knew about this for years. And, I hold them responsible really for the whole thing throughout.
Who responsible?
The gas company.
Yeah, 3 weeks before the moratorium came in, the new lines were put across the river and all the way to UMass before.
Yeah, they realized this problem years ago, quite some years ago. This was the old burn plant. I knew some guys that worked there,
I mean, there was an alternative. In my view, the alternative was to expand the LNG farm in Waitley.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be expensive, but the reality was it would not incur or result in the moratorium the way it has. That simply was rejected on their part.
And it's not the gas company as a whole, because, they're coming through Pennsylvania and New York and with a fifth and sixth 24-inch line, supply line. So they're making some type of progress, but this particular company here that takes care of this area.
If you look historically, so people wanted gas because gas was clean, cleaner than coal. So we eliminated the coal burning plant and cleaner than oil. And so the demand certainly has increased, but the availability of gas has not kept up with the increased demand. So I think it's something that has been a long time coming, but has really been, exacerbated and getting much worse over the last few years.
So then the last thing that we had was the schools. So the Chapter 70 foundation formula. I know that there's some movement to see if they can get some traction on addressing that. So we were just wondering what you're thinking about that.
There was a special commission And several pieces of legislation to file, and I'm co-sponsoring several of them in terms of saying, yeah, let's go to the implementation. The reality is that the funding formula, the foundation, things have changed today than they were, you know, just like the salaries are different than they were in the 90s, and then certainly things are different than it was when we did ed reform in the early 90s. So the things that were never anticipated that should be factored into the funding formula, looking at what is involved in foundation. Above and beyond that, I think there's also, you know, the reality, you've got to look at charter and choice. And not have charter and choice wind up in a situation that it's, you know, essentially it almost needs a dedicated funding stream. You should not be subjected to losses projected or anticipated or unanticipated based on charter and choice.
Well, what's killing us right now is vocational education and special ed mandates.
Yep. There also been legislation looking at trying to adjust the cap in terms of the circuit breaker for special ed.
Mm-hmm.
I signed on that one as well. The vocational issue, it's an interesting one. I mean, the governor last year wound up, you know, providing new grant monies and funding to try to expand vocational opportunities and vocational schools. But the question is, you know, at what cost to local schools?
Right.
And then the problem is even here is compounded even worse, you know, looking at the structure and what exists at Elder Road Smith. You know, Smith needs facilities. Northampton is going to wind up paying for those facilities, although they got a smaller percent. I mean, this is not just a Hadley issue. It's an issue, you know, across the valley. South Hadley has started a culinary arts and a carpentry program to avoid
the drain.
The $18,000, you know, per pupil drain. I think we need to look at what is reasonable and what exists potentially in terms of alternatives.
We've been unhappy for years for taxation without representation. We have absolutely no voice on the board over there and never had that, regardless of how we kick and scream and yell. So that's really a poor system for us.
You know, tonight's a meeting with you. I talked to Annie McKenzie. I'm actually going to wind up scheduling something to go sit with the school committee as well. So I want to sit with the school committees as well as select boards and, you know, and all the communities. Granby was the first one. I think I did it last week. You guys are second. And this doesn't have to be, you know, once a year. I know all of you. I have a relationship with all of you. And people have not been reluctant to call me when needed or to email me. And David as well. But I'm happy to come anytime, you know, whatever I can do in terms of, you know, the more communication we have, the better. As I said, I can represent you, whether representing you as a board with the issues before this as a board, or representing the community and getting input from you as well as the citizens of the community in terms of, you know, what can I do for Hadley?
Yeah, just like you said, you know, now the citizens see that you're making the attempt along with us, you know, for a simple project like the Bay Road Bridge, you know. Everybody's trying to do their best on this. It's,
I wish the heck it was a simple project.
Yeah. It should be anyway.
Yeah.
So anybody have anything else for John today? If not, John. Dave? Yeah.
You know, I was just going through my calculations in my head about all the state money that you've brought to the town of Hadley since
scary.
I've been here. And, you know, I easily topped $1 million, and I was still reaching farther out. So thank you very much for all that you do for us.
Yeah.
And so I'll have the select board review the capital plan on the 15th. Does that meet with your schedule? Okay, and we'll be in touch with you on the 16th.
Yep.
There's a couple of things that don't cost money. That I hope that you'll consider. We really appreciate the Municipal Modernization Bill.
Yeah.
It's very, very valuable for the town of Hadley. We've had votes last town meeting. We have votes coming up this spring town meeting and the next fall town meeting in order to implement certain portions of this. We found it very helpful. And I know that there's a round two going around, and so we ask your support for the second Municipal Modernization Bill. It really does help to loosen up the procurements, to get rid of some of the unnecessary regulations, get rid of some of the unnecessary procedures that we have to adhere to, but nobody ever actually demands of us. So that would be very helpful. The other thing would be the public records law and the enforcement side of it. I know that you and I have talked about this, but there is that provision to take cities and towns to court, regardless of whether an administrative process has been followed or not, or exhausted or not. And that would save cities and towns money to avoid unnecessary litigation by just not making it quite so. Not that we're trying to avoid disclosing public records, it's the foundation of the democracy, but going to court is not the answer. Going immediately to court is not the answer. In the budget that I'm going to present to the select board tonight, the legal account is being increased specifically in order to take into account the public records law and its potential impacts to the town of Hadley. So if we could take a look at that, and again, enforcement's fine, but going immediately to court as a first step is not fine.
Both of those things, you know, I can't take any credit for it. It really is Peter Kokot, the rep from Northampton, who chaired state administration, who really did the municipal modernization bill as well as the public records improvements. A couple of things. One is, when we passed legislation on bullying, and this certainly was an issue for South Hadley and the whole Phoebe Prince situation, the bullying bill created and put some provisions in place. The last section of it talked about a commission who's going to review this a year later. You know, there was no assumption that what we did was perfect. And this group, we're also going to wind up looking at this and saying, okay, it's now been in place for a year. What do we need to do to improve it or make any changes? And I suspect that's going to happen with both municipal modernization, which is why it'll be a number, you know, phase two, as well as public records. The input and the feedback from you is important. I mean, we've already heard feedback from communities saying, this is absolutely crazy. People are asking us to put together these things, you know, under public records release. And we're like, no. If you don't have them, you're under no obligation to create this document. You know, and some communities were actually struggling and spending hours of time trying to put something together because somebody thought, I want all of this. Well, we don't keep track of that. If we don't keep track of that and we don't have it in this sort of form, we're not going to put it together for you. So I think this sort of dialogue with specifics in terms of how something affects you negatively or how we should improve, you know, should we do a tweak here or there to make it better, you know, will help us as we go through that second round. Mm-hmm. The reality is that, you know, the very few, interestingly, relatively small number of members of the legislature actually served in town government. Some people served in city government, but a lot of them never served as members of select boards and understand them. You know, I can remember a situation where I had a bill and I presented it and I needed it acted quickly because it was going to be acted on at a town meeting. I don't think it was a Hadley bill, I think it was for South Hadley, it was some provision. And the person who chaired the committee said, well, you know, so what? If they don't take it up this week at town meeting, they can hit it up next week at town meeting. This person assumed the town meetings happen like every week. And I was like, no, you need to understand the way towns work.
Not in this town.
Hadley. Amherst, though. Amherst does.
That's just one. But even there, they're looking to change that. So the bottom line is the communication, I think, is important. So if there are specifics, you know, I'll certainly bring them forward and do whatever I can to try to make improvements.
I don't want to prolong this, but one last question.
Sure.
Concerns me. As you're aware, we've got a couple of major projects going, a senior center and a sub-fire station. Are there any avenues, you know, in the state we could investigate to lessen the cost?
Well, you're not the first person to ask me that, so we're looking right now. I mean, you know, like, for example, the library. Okay, there is funding for libraries. There's a library grant program. You do the design, and then you get a certain portion. There used to be funding for senior centers, and that funding disappeared a while ago. That doesn't mean that you know, we couldn't look as a budget item in terms of trying to provide some funding to supplement what the town's going to contribute in terms of the senior center or for the public safety complex.
On the federal, and I've spoken to Congressman Montgomery, he said there is avenues for to lessen the burden.
Yeah.
But we have to have an approved project, which
yes.
we have now. So I'm going to go back to him and have more discussion. But Senator Rosenberg mentioned something about drainage to me that could help. There's some kind of bill out there for drainage in new construction?
The only thing I've been thinking of, is, I mean, there's the surface water runoff issue potentially.
Yeah, but there's no money allocated for that yet at all.
There
right?
is, there is. I think there is money coming back. It's been a while since we've had it, and I think it's loans in terms of looking at some of the drainage and sewage and water.
So I thought those are SRF loans.
The SRF.
That's not,
that's what we had for the water treatment plant.
But
yeah.
Let me check.
Appreciate that.
You know, the one other thing, when you start looking, I mean, you know, I've always tried to be honest with you guys. A lot of this stuff, you have to be very careful. Some of these things, you know, we can get it into a bond bill. Like the economic development package that we passed last fall was a bond bill. And everybody's saying, well, where's my money? Well, it's a bond bill. And the way bond bills happen is it's almost like a menu in a restaurant. Okay, so we will put in 50 or 100 projects, perhaps, you know, across maybe more, 200 projects across the legislature that could total $50 or $60 million. So there's a project for Hadley, there's a project for Eastham, there's a project for Lowell, this project. The governor gets the entire list and has the ability to say, well, I'll do this one. And that's what happened actually with the dike. The dike went in on an environmental bond bill. And I don't know if you're all aware of it. I mean, it was calling David at 10 o'clock in the morning saying, I need your numbers by 1 o'clock. We're going to vote on an environmental bond bill at 1 o'clock. And if I can get the numbers in by 1 o'clock, it'll be in the bill, which would be a lot easier than trying to amend the bill later. And we get the numbers, and the number they asked for was right on target. Okay, but then the issue was, does the governor release it? And that was part of the struggle, was convincing Governor Patrick to release the money, because that's when the cracks started showing up in the dike. So I think we have to be careful sometimes when we look at funding, and people in the community say, oh, this is great, we got, you know, $500,000 for a senior center, but if it's in a bond bill, we don't have the money until the governor says, okay, out of these 100 items in here, yeah, we'll do the Hadley Senior Center. So he's got the discretion. The bond bill, we basically say, we're giving you approval or authorization to spend money on any of these 100 projects. And you get to choose which project you want. So we also have to be careful in terms of what the source of funding is. If it's bonding, it's not as guaranteed, if you will, or it's easy to access.
So I think, John, did you have one quick question for him? Let me let John go.
Yeah, you talked about the sidewalks going up and down.
Yeah.
Is that going to be in a state layout?
Yes. There's going to be, well, it's in the state layout, but that's part of the problem right now, why it hasn't happened yet, is they're actually getting easements or getting, I don't know whether they're actually going to get deed transfers for small swaths that are on private property.
Can I ask who's going to maintain those sidewalks and who's going to light them?
Good question. It's a state.
I think you said the lighting was part of it.
The lighting would certainly be part of the state's responsibility.
It is, because Route 9, the town pays for that. It's a state layout, and the state should pay for that, for lightening that road and for maintaining it. So they plow all this snow on the sidewalk, and the town's taxed out to no end now, and yet now they're going to throw some more in. And talk about that, we talked it on the planning board about tying in the bike path on South Maple into Route 9. So when they do that, that's all tied in. That would make things safer for that.
Yep, I'm aware of that.
That stretch is probably one of our worst stretches in the whole town, right there.
Yep.
And I certainly would like an answer to that, if you could possibly get it. And I think the maintenance of it is very important to the town.
Looking at the bike path and looking at Route 9 in a close proximity, they did Swift Way down University Drive. Why can't they do something down Middle Street, East Street, West Street, along with down by the malls to the bike path and connect them all together?
Then I had another question on the MS.
Let me get that we're gonna have to wind that as another tip project. So, you know, but yeah, I think it's a reasonable.
That MS for drainage stuff, the EPA empowered this thing. They throw all this stuff on the cities and towns, and the cities and towns are scratching their butt to figure out how they're going to maintain their schools and everything else. Now, hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars, to comply with this. And if they don't comply, they're going to fine you yet. What kind of nonsense is this?
I can tell you that the issue of combined sewer overflow, CSOs, South Hadley was probably the first, one of the first communities in the valley.
Trump had the right idea. Put a squash on that EPA.
The CSO project in South Hadley was done by the town without any reimbursement from the states or the feds. They were the first ones to do it. They did it, you know, they did the right thing. And then other towns came in later and the feds gave them money but didn't give South Hadley money. So I don't disagree with you that there's got to be some support.
And finally, one last thing. The meals tax at UMass.
Yeah.
Everybody else pays meals tax. They sell for profit. They're in on Hadley territory. Hadley gets nothing out of it.
That's actually, we've already addressed that, and we are
do they pay the same as everybody else?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. No, we are. We're collecting it from the Mullen Center and the stadium.
Do they pay it as every other vendor in town?
Yes.
The same share?
Yeah.
Yeah, we went back to the university on it, and they came back to us with an answer. Yeah, the auxiliary services, right?
For a long time, they got away with that.
Thank you so much for coming and spending time with us.
You know what? He said there was five projects on the tip. I think we got to the first one, and then I think maybe we got to two of them, the second one being Bay Road. Was there three other ones, John, that you wanted to discuss?
What you got on the tip is reconstruction on Route 9 from Middle Street to Maple and South Maple.
Mm-hmm. Bay Road.
You got the pedestrian signal installations, two locations along Route 9 near West Street. Mm-hmm. You got the Route 47 resurfacing from Cummins Road to Old River Drive, including a culvert replacement at Russellville Brook.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
You got the sidewalk.
When is that scheduled for, John?
That's just in the design phase, so it's not scheduled at all yet.
Yeah, they changed it because the state took it all over.
Yeah.
But it got a temporary last year.
Yeah. And the last, you got the sidewalks and wheelchair ramp we talked about, and the last one's the Bay Road over the Fort River bridge replacement scheduled. It's in the design phase and scheduled for 2020. So those are actually the six.
Were you, back to that Route 47, were you involved with that South Hadley bridge that they had replaced or not?
Oh yeah, I was, yeah.
But John, I just want to reiterate, because 2020 is when they're going to be doing Route 9 again. So now they're going to correlate that with the Bay Road Bridge and the rest of Route 9 from the farm museum down.
So this is the situation, right?
So we actually talked to MassDOT about that, mm-hmm. and we said we can't have both projects going on at the same time. They've got to be staggered, and they understood that. So one's 2020, the other one's 2021.
Okay. We'll take the bridge first.
That's what happened in East Hampton, was they were going to do the bridge, and then they were going to do this other area, and said, no, we can't, you know, you can't do that because...
They couldn't do both at the same time.
You won't be able to get here from there, so...
You know, in actuality, for a town with only a population of 5,000, we're doing pretty well on receiving grants, and we thank you for everything you do and representing us. We appreciate it.
I always want more. I mean, you're paying taxes, and so the reality is that the tax dollars aren't coming here, they're going somewhere else.
But the competition level was really tough out there for any money.
I agree.
We all still believe, and unfortunately, even with the question I asked at the MMA meeting, they don't know that we exist out this side of 495. Some people in Boston don't even know where we live, John. Other speakers, even at the seminars that you go to, they're not from out this way. They're from Scituate, Duxbury, you know, all in that area.
Well, you know, I got two comments. One comment is, there's a way you can change that, and that's to get more involved in the MMA.
That's right.
I mean, I when I was a selectman, so I got involved in the MMA, got on the board, I became president of the Selectmen's Association. Once a month, I was in the governor's office. You know, the person who advocated the most, it's really kind of interesting, was David Keelson from Chesterfield. Okay, so David Keelson was getting funding for, you know, there were things like the strap program for rural roads. I mean, this guy once a month is in the governor's office, one of 20 people. And kept pounding, you know, the issue of Western Mass and the regional stuff. So I think that's one thing, one way to help. The other thing that we still have not, I think, fully appreciated and seen the impact of is for the first time in 100 years, the Senate President is coming from this area.
Yeah.
You know, from Northampton, from this district. You know. So despite the fact that sometimes people say, well, gee, Stan doesn't want to co-sponsor legislation, he doesn't do budget, that's right, and I understand that. But he's the one who holds, you know,
well, I'm
the power over
I'm
the
people. I'm thrilled he's Senate President.
So I think what's happening is that there is more attention being paid, even on the House side. So the Chairman of Ways and Means, Brian Dempsey, I used to be his vice chairman. So Dempsey and I get along great. The vice chairman of Ways and Means in the House is Steve Kula from Georgia. The chairman of State Administration, which dealt with a lot of this stuff, is Peter Kokot. Ellen Story, who retired, was in the speaker's leadership team. You know, we have never, as a Western Mass delegation, had as much
juice.
Input. And yeah, juice is a good word,
yep.
And as we have right now.
In the in our Hampshire County Select Board Association meetings, Steve was there, and this last meeting we just had.
I know, I was supposed to go, and we were
I know, you guys are still in Boston.
Yeah.
But Hampshire County has, and Franklin County has, the Selectmen's Associations, but Berkshire County doesn't have anything, and neither does Hampden County. Maybe that's something that we all could work on and try to get more communities together.
President of Selectmen's Association right now is from the Berkshires.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But
I'll tell you is, for the first time, certainly since I've in the 14 years I've been in the legislature, we're now putting together, we call it the Western Mass Caucus. And so once a month, the Western Mass legislative delegation is getting together. We're having lunch. Whatever community we're in, whoever's
good.
Represent that community, you're buying lunch.
Good.
So we started off in November, or in December, they were in Holyoke, in January was in Springfield. So, and we've decided that at least through the budget period, we're meeting monthly. We may follow that and say, well, maybe it's quarterly. The one thing that I learned very early on is it makes no difference whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, whether you represent Springfield or South Hadley and Hadley. The only way we get stuff done is by working together. And the reality is that, you know, whether it's, you know, we got a meeting coming up soon at Cooley Dickinson, okay? So Cooley Dick is important to Hadley and Northampton, but there are people in Springfield who work in Cooley Dick, or the people from this area. So it makes no difference what it is, and the only way we can get something done is by working together. There are more reps from Boston than reps and senators from the four Western counties.
Yeah.
And so it's a matter of working together and getting the juice.
If there's more local representation from members of boards like ours, you know, helping you, and the numbers strong should show something somewhere down the line here, you know.
Well, as soon as Joyce retires, we're shipping her down there. Right, Joyce?
Sure.
You know, you referenced to Stan's value. It couldn't be more evident than the funding that the University of Massachusetts is receiving now. And I would say that's almost all attributed to his prowess and how to get that money to the flagship campus.
What do you think, the rest of us are chopped liver?
Well, I'll tell you, well, it's a big aspect.
I'm just,
you know what I mean.
Being
a graduate there, the tuba player for years, you know, things, he's got it in the back of his heart to support the flagship university. So
it's
a good thing.
Not like Notre Dame, no.
So again,
not
thank
quite
you.
The same. Not quite the same.
Thank you for spending the
Thanks.
Time with us.
Appreciate it.
And this time,
thank
I
you.
Think we're going to dedicate an entire evening just to you, because obviously people like talking to you.
That's fine. So, thanks. Okay. Whatever.
Thank
All
you.
Right.
Very
thank
much.
You.
For coming in.
Appreciate
well,
you.
Thanks, Jerry. Thank you.
Good to see you.
Okay. So Why don't we go with the statement of purpose for a fire substation and senior center building committees. David, you drafted something?
Yes, so I drafted, let's see if I can find it.
I've got the memo right here in board docs.
So the last meeting, people decided that they wanted to have a, waiting for this to come up. There it is.
Do the committees have a copy of this?
No, they don't, except Mr. Michkowski's seen it.
Do we have a copy for the
senior center folks? Jennifer, did
yes.
you bring anything?
Yes,
no?
I do.
You do, okay.
Need a second one?
I'm just going to say, because we've got it. Okay.
I think he gave you.
Go ahead, David.
Okay, so I put together a mission statement with composition, reporting requirements, and duration for both building committees, for the fire substation and the senior center. I patterned it off the, something that we had given earlier, like a couple of years earlier, to the municipal building committee. So this will look very familiar, that each building committee shall work to develop and present to the select board a viable plan to design, construct, and make operational a new senior center and a new fire substation, respective of each committee. Work in coordination with the select board and the owner's project manager to select designer, prepare
it says design.
Acceptable to the select board, bid the construction, oversee the construction with assistance, and make functional the building once completed. Regular communication at a minimum, meeting with the select board at each of the select board's meetings for a progress update, and any decisions concerning pay requisitions, contracts, changes to the scope of work, change orders, certificates of insurance, and any other such matters should come to the select board for approval, which, since they're the chief executive officer, that makes sense. Talk about the composition. I won't go over that. We've decided that last meeting. Reporting requirements and duration. Each shall serve as an ad hoc committee and may be reappointed annually as so long as the building construction projects are in process. Mr. Michkowski wanted a change on that last paragraph. We can take this under advisement, give a little bit more time, or...
There was a comment about whether it should be an ad hoc committee or a standing committee, but just generally speaking, is this in concert with everybody's thoughts?
Yes.
Again, we can spend more time on it, but...
Yeah, I thought we were going with an odd number on the committees. What? How did we end up with 10?
Yeah, you guys decided 10.
It was a confusing one last year.
He's a non-voting member. That's
so
right.
It is
but
odd. Okay.
There are it's 11. Actually, there are 11 people. 10 of them are voting. One's non-voting on that fire sub. On that.
I'm sorry. I thought Mr. Michkowski said that there was one gentleman who was no longer part of the committee, who was originally your neighbor, Mr.
He's no longer.
Didn't you tell us downstairs that he was not part of the committee? Your neighbor?
No.
Who?
Paul Picard.
Paul Picard.
Who's the gentleman downstairs you told us what was not going to be part of your committee?
Howard Koski, maybe?
No,
that was
no.
on a previous
no.
committee.
Oh,
no.
Frank
Picard.
No.
Was
alternate.
No.
Vermucci?
No, no. He's more.
Everybody that you guys appointed.
Okay, so is there
the only guy that didn't show, two people didn't show up with Joyce and Paul Picard today because they had other jobs.
But you didn't say that they weren't on the committee. They just weren't at that meeting.
So how many do you have now? Is there 9 or is there 10 voting members?
There's
and I guess your other question was whether or not there should be... Okay.
With Gary not voting, it's 9 of the odd number.
Yes, I think the way this is worded, David.
No, we went
members.
Over this like 9 different times this afternoon.
All right, do you have the names?
We were confused last week.
Let's go get downstairs and let's get the names so that we have them.
There's me, Spanky, Myron Chudzik, Gary Berg, non-voting, Eddie Dukevitz, Willie, Joyce, Donald Pip, Richie, Frankie Aquadro, and Paul Picard.
That is 10 voting members.
But Frank Quadro is the alternate.
Right. He's an alternate?
Right.
So he will not vote?
No. If
he's named.
If he's substituted for somebody.
Only substituting for somebody.
Right.
Okay, so Mr. Quadro was the 10th member?
Okay.
Is that where you guys are at?
Yeah, okay. So it's 9-2 then. There you go. That's
what it was.
Completely agree with.
That's what we came up with last.
So there's really 9.
9 voting members.
9-2, an alternate and a non-voting member.
Okay.
Correct.
Yeah, and I would just comment on that part of the ad hoc committee and maybe be reappointed annually. I would ask that the committees, I'm not speaking for the seniors, but the committees on the building committee, the fire substation, stay on that committee till the fire department occupies that building, and then at that time, that
dissolution,
disband.
Yeah, both committees should see the whole project through, no matter how long.
We're gonna have to double check that. I don't think you can have an open-ended appointment. I think it has to be year, 2 years, 3 years, something like that.
I don't know, we had it open-ended for the elementary school.
We'll
so do you
want
to, so if that's the only sticking point, I think the intent would be that these committees
right.
would stand through the duration of the project. And then can you just check the formality of
yeah.
how we make that
okay.
happen?
Which is everybody's belief, right?
What I think is fair, too, is all the members. If, say, you have a member that's missing most of the meetings, then that person you should try to replace with
replace.
Someone else.
Yeah.
You know, you don't know if the job is, you know, in conflict or what.
Suzanne?
But everything else sounds okay.
We were an appointed committee. We were an ad hoc and then went to be an appointed committee.
Mm-hmm.
So could that be changed?
Yeah, I think that's the language that...
Thank you.
That, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so do we want to hold on voting it until we have a... just the final language?
No, I think we can do
in
principle. I think
sure.
we can vote on that.
Right.
Everybody agrees to this, and this is everybody understands their charge, no additions or deletions. Make a motion that based on the intent of this, we correct the verbiage, we correct the number 10, and we decide whether or not it's truly an ad hoc committee or a appointed committee, and if there's a term or a finalization of the project.
So, second.
Okay, first and second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I would ask you if you could at this time dissolve the ad hoc committee. Because I know you didn't vote.
Well, we need to formally vote to do that,
that,
I think, right? Mm-hmm. Is that correct, David?
Yeah, let's put that on the agenda just to make sure that that's squeaky clean.
For the next meeting.
For the
so it's been posted.
Yeah.
Both.
And one last thing, I think we have to make it aware that all of these people that are appointed have to appear before the town clerk and get sworn in.
Mm-hmm.
You've done that, okay, fine.
Okay. So why don't we go into the update then from the senior center and then the fire substation?
Delighted. We had a meeting today with the OPM, and we have five final candidates that we're going to be interviewing next week. The OPM believes that we can stay on schedule and give you our recommendation with their written backup for your meeting on the 15th. So you
okay,
would like to be on the agenda.
Sure. You got that, Jennifer?
Yes.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. And fire substation?
Yeah. We also had a meeting at 10 o'clock this morning. We were down to 3 applicants. And we're set for the 16th to interview them.
Okay.
And then turn those results and recommendations to the board. And there's also, I would ask the board if it would be okay to look into the process and what we need for the traffic lights in that section over there. And also, is there going to be any chargebacks from your office to this project?
You mean
because,
like administrative chargebacks?
Right, because one thing, no one said anything from the selectman's office or anyone, so we didn't really budget for that. When we reduced our budget from 3.5 to 2.9, that's a lot of money, and it just, I just really want to caution you guys to watch.
You and I sit down, we'll work out a budget, we'll work out all those details.
So that there are no surprises.
Okay.
And same with this.
Then also, right up front, the sewer impact fee, the sewer connection fee, and the water fee, is that going to be waived for a municipal building? You guys have the right to do that.
Why not?
It would be my recommendation, it's for municipal building.
It's all town.
Unless ethically it's not appropriate to do, I would be in favor of waiving that.
Yeah, one thing, we'll just want to look and see if there's any sort of
precedent.
Okay, but I mean, certainly would make sense.
For both projects, so they don't have that expertise.
Okay, so could we just get more information from you on that? But
so is it the intent of the sub-fire station committee to be holding your meetings during the daytime?
No, we're going to try. Thursday nights, really, we had the best turnout. So we, because the OPM wanted to do this, the senior center and ours, so this is why we did it. On Wednesday today, but either we're going to try Thursday night, which worked out good, or Saturday mornings.
So I have a question.
Sure.
I understand the convenience for the OPM if he wants to have both meetings together, but if that doesn't really work, isn't he obligated to come whenever we want to have our meetings?
Yeah, so under the new contract, we're not paying per meeting, we're paying a flat fee.
He said that to us.
Okay,
that's
good.
No problem.
Okay.
Jerry?
I need some clarification as to these projects with our go forward. We have very aggressive schedules on both of them. We made some promises to the municipalities as to when the increases would go up. I've seen some communications back and forth that we need to make this fit when the liens or when the levy, money's coming off the levy. I need to make sure to be able to understand for everybody involved that we're progressing in a schedule which makes sense for everybody, and we fall in line with what we told the citizens. So I think both projects are moving along at hyper speed, okay? I know there'll be some shortcomings and some things coming back due. But if shovels were going in the ground next spring, are we still complying with what we told citizens on the taxes?
So we're doing a lot of work behind the scenes in order to schedule these as well as all the other borrowings that were approved in January. And the idea is that, yes, absolutely, we want to make sure that the debt burden that the taxpayers are shouldering is no more than, and hopefully less than, what we presented. So timing is everything. If all of this hit all at once, we would be seeing a very big increase in taxes. That's why we're spreading this out as much as we can, timing everything so that we can take advantage of low interest rates, scheduled payments, payments to come in when other payments are going off. So we're working very closely with Linda and the financial management team, and we'll be working very closely with the building committees so that communication is happening. And right now we seem to be right on track with all the projects moving forward at the time that we need them to, so we can control the costs. And the
cost came up as an issue today. Is one of the things is that, you know, we always talk about programs, and I know we fast-tracked, and when we went and did the water treatment plant, it took us more than 2 years to get that up and running, and we had a perchlorate gun to our head to get done. So I know these things take time. However, the more time they take, the further off budget you get. It's just the way it happens. So everybody's trying to come in on their budgets that they put together and made some promises to the taxpayers. But we want to do that so it comes in line with the money coming off the levy, so everything's working and everybody's doing what we said we were going to do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I mean, that's very, very important. I want to stress to that, and everybody understands where we are with that, so that we proceed in the process that goes in line with what we told them and what everybody's, how they're trying to go forward with it now.
John?
So,
yeah, that was pretty much what Linda had to say last night at the meeting.
Yeah.
And she's going to make a graph that will be easily understood by everyone about when that happens and what happens next and where that money comes from.
Suzanne?
Can I just clarify what I'm hearing is that it's not definitive at this point whether our schedule is going to be able to be financed as it stands right now?
No, we're not saying anything like we're trying to purposely delay a project in order to make it affordable to the taxpayers. We put together our projection based upon conservative estimates that involved high interest rates, 5%. It involved an aggressive pay down schedule. It involved these projects going faster than they probably will go. So, you know, the key to all of this is going to be constant and complete communication.
Yeah.
And timing this is a very important, letting us know in advance what your timing, what your schedule is going to be, is very, very helpful. That way we can do the work that we need in order to shape how we're putting these debt packages together so that it'll be affordable.
David, can you correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is the treasurer is going to try to borrow the least amount of money she can before July 1st.
Right, so not
to lessen the impact.
Not the least, but certainly enough to get these some of the short-term projects done. So the $185,000 for the DPW equipment, the two cruisers, those can go forward. We have the first part of MS4 compliance that can go forward. So these things can go forward at an appropriate schedule. I'll be asking you to sign a contract for the Connecticut River dike subsurface analysis. That project's not going to happen until after July. We won't have to make any payments until July 2018 on that. So those are the kinds of things that we're doing in order to structure this debt so it's affordable.
Okay. John?
Yeah, when we had our meeting with the OPM, we decided to say, look, we got a place, the fire station is not there, it's not going to fall down. So if this project takes six more months and to comply with the funding and to do a good job, if that's the difference, that's the route we're going to take.
Mm-hmm. And that came up today as well.
Same thing here.
Yeah.
Build it once and build it right.
That's right.
The wait is this long, so this.
Okay.
I think we're all on the same page.
Excellent. Let's do everything we can to stay that way. So we'll see you on the 15th.
Yep. Wait a minute. How much reporting are they being? Are they doing?
They're coming every meeting, it says.
Yeah. I mean, I think realistically, if there's a situation where there's nothing to report, then we would
have our delegate.
Yes.
I thought last.
I guess that's
last
the point I'm trying to do.
We want to leave them on
the
agenda all the time anyway.
Yeah, we meet the 16th.
Every meeting.
No, report on the 15th.
Right.
And I would like to take this opportunity to invite you all this Friday at 2 o'clock to come and meet the new program coordinator at the Senior Center. We're having a reception to welcome her.
Friday when?
Friday at
2
o'clock.
2 o'clock. All right, thank you. So
Martini
just sticking
served.
With the theme,
right.
Why don't we go into the discussion of North Hadley Hall. So we put this back on the agenda because had some feedback from the ZBA and some other folks who were just feeling a little bit not conflicted, but just having difficulty with the way that the situation has been left. At the last meeting, we had Mr. Greenbaum here, and he wanted to let the select board know that he's still interested in pursuing some sort of project at the North Hadley Hall. So he was keeping his hat in the ring, so to speak, relative to moving ahead with a purchase and sale, obviously subject to him getting whatever zoning modifications might be required from the ZBA. From the ZBA standpoint, you know, we're moving ahead with the fire substation project, and so we're coming to them looking for variances because of the non-conforming lot. Their preference would be to have everything in front of them at the same time as opposed to kind of splitting this up, because it just makes it more difficult for them. And yet as a select board, we still, and you know, obviously town meeting spoke, but as a select board, it's really up to us whether or not we want to continue along with this purchase and sale and have again, Joel keep his hat in the ring, or whether or not we want to send the message, no, we're done with it. And we haven't really voted on it. There was some discussion, but it seemed like at the time people were coming at it from different angles. So in the spirit of helping our fellow elected officials along here with their task at hand, was hoping that maybe tonight we could, you know, have some conclusion about where this board stands relative to that purchase and sale agreement with Mr. Greenbaum. The other piece of this, of course, is also, as you heard Joel at the last meeting say, that he has some ideas about what he might be bringing back to the ZBA, but that hasn't been formulated quite yet, because he was deferring to us to say, well, I'll give you guys as much time as you need, but maybe we need to put it around the other way and say, if we're going to stay the course, then he needs to figure out what it is he's going to do with that and get that in front of the ZBA sooner rather than later. So
I'm of the opinion we should do nothing until the final ball light bulb is put into the North Hadley Fire Station, and then decide whether or not he's still interested in it.
Absolutely. He said he's still interested in it. And as far as the historic
preservation.
Mm-hmm. And most of the people in the center of town, I don't know about all of them, I've been hearing both sides of the story, you know, I don't think the people are going to vote to knock it down and presumably preserve that land after they already voted to get rid of it all. I think we came to a happy medium where we split the lot right now, and that both parties can be happy, and I think it's a pretty reasonable offer what he has come up to this point from where he had started.
Yeah, again, you know? I think from the ZBA standpoint, what they're looking for is for us to say that we're supporting keeping that option open.
Yeah.
They want to know that that's where we stand, or that we don't stand there as they're hearing these.
But absolutely we shouldn't do anything until the new station's built, for sure.
Would you like that in a motion form for discussion?
Yes.
I would like to make a motion that we take no action on the North Hadley Town Hall School, Village School, until such time as the fire station is complete and we understand our options at that time.
I'll second that.
Okay.
Discussion.
Yeah.
Okay. Any further discussion on that, David?
Just to point out that the vote to sell the town meeting, the town meeting vote to sell the North Hadley Village Hall dates to 2014. So by the time we're going to be selling this, once the building is completed, we'll have to re-vote that. That vote will be too old for that.
Why? It's still in negotiations. It's still open.
I'm just letting you know what the end result is going to be. Is we're going to have to re-vote that.
Why?
Because the vote will be too stale, and the real estate attorneys will not.
Let's just do it then. That's okay.
Understood.
Right.
Motion and second on the floor.
Okay, and for discussion or.
I'm inclined to agree with Mr. Devine. You know, his motion is a good motion. My problem with the whole situation is the ZBA voted against it because they said it was in violation of our zoning bylaws, no apartments. And I don't think they're going to change that. And
they may not, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. Unless Mr. Greenbaum has a bona fide reason to go back to change it, and at this point, after discussing with him, I don't see one at this point yet. He would have to make some significant changes to have another hearing.
Mm-hmm. Well, then, he was willing to say that he would wait until whenever we made that decision. So, I mean, it's still on the table at some point when the station is done. Period. Mm-hmm. Let's go for a vote.
Okay. All right. So, everybody comfortable? We'll communicate that back to ZBA.
Please.
Yep. Okay. All in favor?
I'd still like to see something in the law where it says, what is stale? Is that
3 years?
Chapter and section of the law?
3 years. So if you're going to sell town property, you need a town meeting vote of a two-thirds majority.
Yeah.
All right. Any real estate attorney will tell you, and as they've told me, is that if the vote is longer than 3 years in the past, then you don't know if town meeting has changed its mind. Circumstances may have changed. So they will insist that you revote that.
So it sounds like it's more of a legal precedent as opposed to being the law itself.
But if it's still in negotiations, then I think it would still be binding.
That's not what's on the table right now. Okay, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. All right, thank you.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Jesus. Has that property ever been appraised?
Yes.
By who?
Oh, wait, appraised.
It's not been appraised. It's been assessed.
Assessed.
I know, but don't you think selling a piece of property, it protects the board, it protects the town. The certified appraiser appraises it, and then you got an actual appraiser, not a guess, not a picking a figure out of the sky.
And again,
the last ZBA hearing, the planning board members that were there opposed the apartments. Mm-hmm. And I suppose this comes again, it's going to be a unanimous appeal if they put apartments. I would think the town and the Board of Selectmen would benefit if, like Jerry said, put this out till they occupy the building, then put this out to bid and see if you can get over 55 housing there and rebuild that building, use some CPA funding in there, and I think you got a real win-win situation. Because when the planning board had a meeting back, I think 3 years ago there, it was overwhelming. In the village, they picked over 55 housing as their number one priority. Mm-hmm. And I think it'd be a home run for everybody. So it's good that you, and I'm thankful that you're waiting until the fire department basically occupies the building, gets out there, and then at that time, get it appraised, get it assessed, and if you have to take it to town meeting to talk about it, so do it. And I do have a hearing with the ZBA, and it was supposed to be put on the last hearing to just, our building is over 2,500 feet in an overlay district. You've got to have a variance for that, and it's just standard procedure. But the setback's been ruled on, everything else has been ruled on, so that's going to happen, I guess, the next ZBA hearing.
Okay. All right, so we all set with this then?
Yeah.
Okay. So next, see, Connecticut River Levy subsurface contract.
Was this bid?
This is engineering work, so it doesn't need to be bid.
Just part of Marlo's budget, right?
This is part of what was passed at the January vote.
Does it not make sense to bid that project when it's $125,000? Are there other companies that do this?
It's up to the board.
How did this come about?
So we did a selection of engineers several years back to do the investigation into the dike. AMEC was the company that rose to the surface, and they've performed this. Two of the four phases of the investigation into the dike. And so
were they the ones that came and made the presentation?
Absolutely, they were the ones.
So we're just staying the course.
I wasn't there with it, so I just didn't know how the process was progressing. Yeah. I didn't know if we had done any business with them in the past or you were happy with them.
Yeah, the first two phases, and this was third, and I think they got one more.
One more after this.
So, good question, but that's, so that's why we're just staying the course with the original.
So the original phases went out to bid originally, and they were the low bidder?
They didn't technically go out to bid. Again, this is engineering work, which is not subject to the procurement laws. I guess they have good lobbyists in Beacon Hill. But we did review a number of engineering firms, decided that Stantec was not the one.
I'm all for that.
Second that.
But we also looked at Western and Sampson, we looked at Ty and Bond, we looked at CEI, and it seemed like AMEC had the technical capacity to do this for the price that we were looking for. So if you want me to go out to bid, I can.
No. Right. I'm very happy now that what you've passed along. There's some dates I think that need to be adjusted in here. I think 2016 was mentioned as when they were going to start. And on page 2 of 4, it said borings along the levee toe will have an average depth of 20 feet.
Yep.
Yeah, so? Why?
How deep did we drive that sheathing? 80 feet?
I don't remember that.
I'm no engineer, and I'm going to quit playing it in a second. I'm just making sure that the 20 feet that's there, somebody can tell me that that's a reasonable depth to investigate a toe to find out whether or not the substructure is going to...
I think they got all that information from the last incident there, and I think that's all into consideration with the clay shear and everything, what they ran into with the cave-in. But, you know...
Is that 20 feet where that clay bed is?
Below the toe. So at the bottom of it, where the support is there, it's not from the top of it, it's from down below.
That's the important part, that holds that whole bed.
Yeah, because that was a shear.
They did that all along the North Hampton site. Yes.
And 20 feet is the appropriate depth? Okay, thank you.
Right. So one of the things I'm thinking about is at some point the Army Corps of Engineers is going to work their way up, and FEMA's going to work their way up the Connecticut River, looking at all the dikes and looking for compliance to their standards. We've seen them working in Hampton County. They seem to have run out of steam with Holyoke and West Springfield and Springfield. But one of these days they are going to be coming up here, and doing this work right now makes sense, both in terms that we know next to nothing about that dike, which is critical for protecting the center of town.
Well, they couldn't even jump in. Let's not even go with that Army Corps of Engineer. That really kind of...
Joyce, looking at the big picture, if the new president's going to open up all these job creations and get rid of some of the environmental laws, well, maybe some of these jobs can get done.
Okay, we'll let David finish with his thought.
So the other thing is that there will be a day, and I don't know when that day is going to be, but there will be a day when FEMA will examine your levy and say, we need this to be at a certain standard code. It needs to comply with a certain standard code. The work that we're doing now is in anticipation of meeting those standards, or at least being at least a couple of steps down the road. So the 20 feet is going to be complying with FEMA's regulations, I think.
All right, so my next point is to you then, if they're going to be coming up the river and checking all these things out, do you think they're going to be doing or accepting our geotechnical analysis of our levee, or do you think they're going to be actually doing it themselves?
They will not do the work. They will.
They were really clear on that.
They'll mandate that we do the work.
Mm-hmm. This, remember Katrina and what happened after that. Mm-hmm. So,
okay. this
whole levee analysis started after the fact that the federal government realized that they were on the liability hook, and this is an attempt to shift that liability over to the states and cities and towns. So this is a long range program that is not going to slow down, I think.
Yeah, and it seems like now that they've closed Vernon power plant down, that river's freezing up a lot more than it has in the past years. And I think at some point, if we ever get a real cold winter, we may end up with an ice block down there about the South Hadley-Holyoke line, and we could have our 500-year flood here eventually, unfortunately.
It's we're a foot higher than Hatfield anyway, so we're all set for that.
Well,
it's going to flow the other direction.
Yeah.
So do we don't need to vote this? You just want us to sign
it? I want you to vote it, please, for the chair to sign.
I can't recall. What was the allocation from town meeting? Was it 140?
121,000. Was it 121?
121 for the...
So it's exactly the amount of the bid.
Right.
That's strange.
I think we had the bid, so we knew what the number.
We
knew what the number was going to be. We had the bid in our hands.
That's why we put that number in.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't think we did.
I'll make a motion to accept the geotechnical
Is there a second?
For the Levi levy.
Levi levy. Okay.
Levy Levi.
Is there a second on Joyce's motion? To accept the bid?
Sure.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Is there further discussion on this? You're shaking your head, Jerry.
No. I'm inclined to go out with Jerry. I think we should go out to bid and see if there's some other applicable people that we may lower that down. I don't know. And if they come in on a bid process, 121, we're there anyway.
Well, we certainly don't want the ones that come in lower that did it the last time, let me tell you.
Well, maybe they'll sharpen their pencil and drop it by 20,000. We don't know that.
I think Joyce is saying that the people that were overseeing it when it fell in is people we don't want. And if we have to take the lowest bid.
I agree with that also, but.
Yes.
I know there's a cost factor. David, how much to go out to bid is it going to cost us?
I think you're getting a bargain at 121.
You know, and I think this company has done the first couple of phases, and they're well aware of the situation we were in.
Yeah, and it's going to be a big learning curve for somebody to jump in.
Exactly.
Johnny, how well were they qualified?
Well, they've done the first two parts for us, John, and this is a lot of this stuff is all under the FEMA regulations. They had came in and they gave us a couple presentations, I believe, didn't they, over the past few years?
They did phase one, phase two.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And
you know, I just like to comment, there's a big difference. I did a lot of stuff on waterways, on standing water and moving water.
Yeah.
Big difference. And if they don't have no experience in moving body of water,
they could be serious.
They had a lot of references
they came in with, John. Yeah.
Motion second on the floor, Chair.
Jerry, could I ask you why you're having such a problem with this? There must be a reason behind it.
It's killing me that if we're investigating our levy and if we come back with information, then what's the next step? Does that mean we got a $13 million fix to redo our entire levy all along the side? I'm of the opinion that if it ain't broke, don't fix it at this point in time. We had a problem in the past. We understood where it was. It became an emergency, and I don't want it to sound like it's a safety issue and we're, you know, that our levee's caving in and that the sky is falling Chicken Little. I don't think that's it.
I think this is called proactive management. Yeah. What we're trying to do is get in front of this, because the last thing we want to do is have another issue and saying, why didn't you follow through?
And highway department over the last 30 years I've been there have done preventive maintenance on it. They've cut the dike every few years. They've done
We've had three fixes on there already.
I know.
So, I mean, that's why we said after the last time that it happened that we would be proactive and making sure that that didn't happen again and face what we faced back then, even if we had to spend some of that money.
And town meeting voted to appropriate the funds.
They also
agree that this is important.
Does this do the whole shore?
It does the whole map.
Levy.
It actually goes along the railroad tracks as a secondary.
It shows it, John, all the way to just below Cross Path.
It runs right along the bike path also, either side of
the bike path. There's erosion all the way down past Mitch's Marina.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded to approve the signing of this contract. We're ready to put it to a vote?
Yes.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. So unanimous? Did you vote? You voted. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Okay. And we have a water abatement, 227 Russell Street.
Yeah.
Motion accept.
You want to take a look at that?
Pardon?
Motion accept.
You want to take a look at the...
Oh, the abatement, yes.
The points.
Okay.
Second.
Where they're going
okay.
to go.
Motion made and seconded on the abatement. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
For those wondering how that was done so fast, it was our fault. It was a mistake on our end, which was clearly a mistake was recommended to us.
Okay. And then we also have town report dedication. We started this discussion last week. This is the dedication for the annual town report and also the Fred Oakley Award for volunteerism. Looking for any nominations from the board this evening? Yes?
I have four nominations that have come in. Ray
Zala.
Thank you, Zala.
Zala. Yeah.
Glenn Clark, Frank Zillot, and Marilyn Judah are the ones that have come in for the dedication. We have not received anybody for the...
Frank has already had it dedicated to him.
Okay.
Okay. So Marilyn Judah, as folks know, is a
Teacher.
Art teacher at Hopkins Academy. She sadly passed fairly recently, and certainly did an awful lot for the kids. Probably had just about every kid that rolled through here for her 30-year career. And then you said Frank Jala, right?
Ray Jala.
No, you said he's had it dedicated, or Frank Zaylot?
Frank Zaylot has.
Has already had it done.
Is what I was told.
Okay. And
Glenn Clark.
Ray is the
Glenn Clark,
the owner of the Old Hadley Flea Market. And then Glenn Clark.
And Ray is also an assessor.
And he's on a board of assessors. Yep. And then Glenn Clark has been on multiple committees. I think maybe most recently the Finance Committee, but then he's on the Council on Aging as well.
I would make a nomination for Mr. Clark to receive the Fred
Second.
Oakley Award.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
the what?
Oakley?
Fred Oakley Volunteerism Award.
And
will also be part of the annual report.
Make a nomination that the book be dedicated to Marilyn Judah and Mr. Jala. Can we do two nominations for that?
Sure. I mean, is there anybody else? But just before we vote, did anybody else?
Has it done already? It's
he
been
already
done to him
done.
Already.
Yeah.
But it was an excellent suggestion.
Yeah. Anybody else have anything before we vote?
No.
Okay. So all in favor of accepting? Oh, was there a second on Joyce's recommendation?
Both of them. You going to do it all at once, or you going to split them?
Just do it at once.
Sure.
Second both.
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. You got that, Jennifer?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
All righty. So then we have the FY18 budget. Mr. Nixon?
Can we just do the town administrator report, because I'll make it very short, but there's a couple of things that we need to do.
As long as that is the...
Very short, okay. Very, very, very short. So first thing has to do with the Berkshire Gas moratorium. I'm asking you all to sign a disclosure letter confirming that KP Law is representing both the town of Hadley and the town of Amherst in our intervener case with the Department of Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities. So that letter is in front of you tonight. The other is our Commonwealth Compact report came in. We each have a copy of it, so feel free to read that. And at your next meeting coming up, the financial management team reviewed the practically non-existent agreement between the town and the schools for the net school contribution. We developed a comprehensive draft of that that was approved by the school committee Monday night, so I'll be asking you to approve it at your next meeting.
What is that?
This is, it's not chargebacks where we exchange money or receive money from the schools, but it's the credit that we receive for all of the things that we do for the schools, such as plowing, such as the retirement contribution, the benefit administration, other things like that that we do for the employees.
And it's non-monetary other than how it gets reported to the state.
Right, so it goes towards fulfilling your net school contribution. There's a minimum that you're supposed to spend, both in terms of direct appropriation and basically in-kind services.
And the schools agreed to the formula.
They've agreed to the formula, so I'll be bringing it back, but I just wanted to give you a little bit of background on it. That's all I have for the town administrator report. If you could vote to sign that letter from KP Law.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor of signing KP Law letter?
Aye.
Aye.
Could I ask David to explain the OPEB actuarial a little bit?
Yeah, so
what's going to transpire and the time element?
Yeah, so every 2 years, every city and town district and authority has to do an actuarial study of its future costs for health care, dental insurance, and life insurance for all of its employees on the supposition that everybody is going to retire on June 30th of a particular year. For the town of Hadley, we've done want to say four of these actuarial studies were due to complete another one this fiscal year, 2017. We have money in the budget for that purpose, and we have that work scheduled for the spring, and so we should be getting a new actuarial report at that time, which will tell us our numbers.
We haven't made a decision in this budget about if that's going to become part of the omnibus budget or it's going to be dealt with separately.
I'm recommending that it be handled as part of the omnibus budget. And
it's been financed at how much?
It's been financed in
$260,000,
basically. Let me bring that figure up for you. Give it to you in a second. $257,403 is the recommended funding level, which would be 2.5% above this current year's funding level. It gets you halfway to the magic number of 269, which is your 35-year pay down at 7% interest.
Very good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Anything else, or can we go into the budget?
What? No. When's Koppelman and Page's contract up again?
You have a year-to-year with them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know,
in the past, we've brought them in.
I know. Back to Donald's statement last week, yet I thought about it a little bit. And I looked on the back of the Beacon, and there must be six or eight mm-hmm. firms that mm-hmm. are advertising their services for municipalities. Mm-hmm. You know, and I just think it's good to change once in a while. As I said before, so it's something to keep in the back of our minds, I guess.
So, yeah, there's no harm in looking. And in the past, we had them come in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But when was the last time we actually went out to bid on the council?
Yeah, you haven't gone out to bid for a very long time. I don't know.
Or solicited.
I can't remember when that happened.
Not since you've been here, right?
Since I've been here.
Fired Joe Bard.
Okay, so we can talk about. You want to talk about that?
Yeah.
When it comes up, not now. Let's get the budget.
Sure. Okay. But I just, Donald had made a statement last mm-hmm. week, and I thought about it later on. And
yeah, there are a lot of vendors
and
out there.
And I had brought it up, and then I seen it on the back of the Beacon. And
Okay. Yeah, we'll put that on the list, John.
Yeah.
So FY18 budget, what would you like us to know?
Okay, so I'm just going to talk very briefly because the hour is getting late.
Are you going to be doing a summary sheet, or where should we be?
Yeah, there is a summary sheet.
Is that where you're working off of?
Yes, it's...
Okay. I just want to be where you are.
If you want to be on page 16, that has the letter of transmittal to the select board. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I am going to say the following, that it's a balanced budget based upon the estimated receipts and the recommended expenditures based upon the adjustments that I've made and the transfers of funds that are recommended. The goals and objectives for 2018, the first goal was public safety. Back in 2017, we made a commitment that we were going to enhance our public safety services for the town of Hadley. We worked first with the police department, and we committed to increasing the patrol officers by at least three full-time positions within the first 6 months of the fiscal year. And by October 2016, we did secure that funding, and the police department achieved its staffing goals in that year. For 2018, we have set the goal of adding four full-time firefighters to the roster.
That's been discussed. I don't know if that's a set goal. It's been discussed.
Okay.
And that was all supposed to be the ambulance committee and needs and all of that, I thought.
Yeah, I mean, I think the specific discussion was we gave, Mike Spanknebel came in front of us, actually with Mike Mason as well, if I remember serves me correctly, and said that this was all discussed in the context of going for the SAFER grant, and then, so
that,
we voted.
That failed.
We voted to go ahead, but if the SAFER grant failed, we said we agreed in principle with the, you know, moving towards a full-time fire force. So, I mean, I think to Jerry's point, you know,
These are goals that we're
These are goals, right.
These are goals. I don't want to say that it's fixed and hard in stone here.
Yep.
There may be a hybrid. Maybe we can hire a couple. But I'm not supportive of four people being hired tomorrow, so just to let everybody know. If it may be something that we're going to need to and have to do, but I'm not sold yet.
Okay.
Well,
so,
I have good news for you.
I was going to say.
It's not in the budget.
Yeah.
Okay, that's not good news, but yeah. I wished we could fund it all.
Well, it's projected in our discussion that would be our number one priority. Only we didn't vote to do it at that
exactly.
time.
That was
exactly,
my point.
You know,
exactly.
And,
yeah.
You're right, Chair.
Okay.
Yep. So.
So this is a budget proposal with goals and objectives. And if you don't like goals and objectives, we can certainly amend them. So just going on to the second goal, which is to talk about Public Works. We have a new director of Department of Public Works who's able to introduce and implement a number of new programs and services, including a work order system, GIS mapping of infrastructure, enhanced oversight of the Route 9 water line replacement project, as well as addressing several key capital improvements, namely the MS4 stormwater permit compliance project, equipment for the road work, wastewater clarifier replacement project, and the Connecticut River levee structural assessment, which you just approved that tonight. So that was FY17. And 18, we're looking to create efficiencies in the DPW in order to enhance the value of the work that they do every day. In addition, we'll be reviewing water and sewer rates to promote water conservation and achieve service level solvency and fiscal solvency. So we'll be bringing that information to you in the next month or so. Goal number three, building maintenance. In FY17, we municipal building maintenance budget was increased to support the town's effort to upgrade its aging buildings, keep them in good running order. Several important projects were initiated in 17, including a new roof for the public safety complex, funding for a new senior center and fire station, and approval of the submittal of a grant to construct a new library. So in 2018, the municipal maintenance budget will be reorganized to combine the separate building-related accounts into a single maintenance account under the direction of the DPW. Building maintenance items such as custodial services, maintenance contracts, alarm systems, groundkeeping, and repairs have been consolidated into a unified budget for greater accountability and control over the town's maintenance effort. And there's a chart showing where I've transferred money from other accounts to the building maintenance account. The total value of those transfers is
$46,250.
In addition, not only am I transferring money into this from other accounts, I'm increasing the budget for repairs in order to provide for enhanced building maintenance overall. The base budget for the general building maintenance was increased from $61,500 in 2017 to $81,450 in 2018. The transfers bring the total budget up to $127,700 for this coming year, total of increase of 107%. So basically, I've doubled the budget there. Goal number four, financial management. In FY 2017, we amended our aggressive strategy for OPEB costs, other post-employment benefits. We'll go into the details. We decided to amend that strategy, and instead of going up by $80,000 per year, that we would go up by 2.5% and achieve a plateau of in 2020. This we'll be increasing in FY18 the annual OPEB contribution by that 2.5%, raising the annual contribution to $257,403. The other financial management goal was to implement the new free cash policy. In essence, you wanted us to reduce the reliance upon free cash for recurring operational expenses by $75,000 each year and maintain at least $75,000 of free cash available for other purposes. The budget that's submitted to you tonight achieves those purposes. And you can see the spending plan on page 22. Stabilization fund.
Can we get that OPEB funding plan with the expected outstanding balance per year after our deductions?
So I'm not following the question.
It's going up every year, and we're making contributions. Where are we? What we've contributed to what we owe.
Okay.
What we're putting in every year and what the balance would be.
So what you're putting in, what I'm suggesting that we put in this year will bring us to about the $1 million mark. It'll be a little higher than $1 million at that point.
So when we get to the detailed budget discussions, we'll have all that information.
Oh,
in front
yes,
of us.
You'll find it on or in great detail.
It's in the book, yeah.
It's in the book.
All right.
I guess the only question I have is to make this all work, how much does our free cash have to increase? So we go to fall town meeting again and apply it to the overall budget. I come up with about 500,000.
Yeah, that's what
pretty
I
close.
No, it's right on. That's what I estimated that we'll get in free cash.
Okay.
So which is
I added
which
the
is,
figures, that's
is,
what I came up. And that's including that's leaving the 75,000 in free cash too.
Correct.
Okay. So it's like 425.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
If you wanted to if you wanted to reduce the 75 down to zero, then 425 would be your base number.
And at this point in time we have not touched the meals tax.
At this point in time we haven't touched the meals tax.
Which is staying steady right now?
Growing.
It's growing. Okay. So it used to be that we were getting $60,000 every quarter for meals tax. That's up to $80,000 per quarter. So that just keeps on growing. So we'll engine that. And then finally, under financial management, our goal is to start adding back into the stabilization fund. If you remember that we had to take money out of stabilization in order to fund the retro pay on the collective bargaining agreement, so now it's time to start paying that in. I've put in a modest amount of $5,000 in order to start adding back in there. And that's where we are at this point.
Okay. So in terms of next steps then, the tri-board meeting is scheduled for the 15th.
Mm-hmm.
The school department, the school figure, David, that you used for this purpose?
I used the number that they presented to us on Monday night, which is 7,150,000 and change.
For level services, not
level
enhanced.
Services, right. Yeah. But I also included wherever there's an enhancement of the program. So, for example, fire or where else, the school department, I've included a statement that they've wanted to enhance their budget and how much that enhancement would look like.
Okay.
So for the schools, they wanted an additional $112,000.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so has your financial management team at Town Hall reviewed this yet, the revenues and the like?
No. Well, the revenues we've all had a chance to look at because we talked about that back in December, but I was literally finishing this document about 6 hours ago, so nobody but you have seen this.
Okay, but Dan Zadonik and Linda, the revenues?
Yes, everybody's looked at the revenues.
Okay.
This is going to be available.
I would just like to make a comment about page 24. And how it breaks down, you know, even with the money that we're spent at the ballot question, we're looking at $11.57 for our tax rate. You look at that chart there, it goes all the way up for Shutesbury to 22.76. The closest to us is Hatfield, 13.22. But most important, you follow the years from fiscal year 2006 up to 13, we're A+, AA. In the last 4 years, we're AA+.
Mm-hmm.
which is fantastic. Mm-hmm. You know, and I commend you for that, David.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's a team effort.
Okay, so we have a tri-board scheduled for the 15th.
All right.
So we want to make sure that, you know, the finance committee gets whatever information they need, right, mm-hmm. in advance of that.
Yeah.
But the schools know what figure you're using, if you haven't told them already.
Yeah.
Okay, and then we'll be coming up with a game plan in order to go through this departmentally.
Right, so you'll want to start scheduling meetings with departments, and obviously there's a lot of need out there that's not going to be met by budget recommendation, and so we need to make sure that we act in the most responsible way for the town.
Mm-hmm. I have one further question. I guess this is for the board.
Sure.
I know we considered an override. We basically took off the table. Would it be, you know, premature to maybe put it back on because of the school's problematic budget, maybe wanting to get the four firemen for the fire department?
Yeah, I'm thinking that at the tri-board meeting, we should commit some time focusing on what's not included in a balanced budget.
Yeah.
And articulate that and make sure that everybody
understands
yeah. exactly what's not in here. Donald, is that what you're getting
I'm at? I'm a firm believer now, after the 9 ballot questions passing, if the citizens get the proper information why it's a necessity to do this, I think they react properly as long as they're informed voters.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still in a good environment to do it. Our tax rate is still low. The economy is good, and it may be something, I think it's our responsibility as elected officials to give the citizens an opportunity to do this. If they say no, we've done our job, giving them the opportunity.
That gives us direction where we're
headed. But if we don't give them an opportunity, we haven't done our job.
Yeah. Yeah. So
that's the way I feel.
And I think the first step in the process is making sure, again, that we're all looking at each other and the tri-board's looking at each other, articulating what's not in here and what we're supportive of perhaps moving forward with that can only come from an enhanced revenue source, right?
You know, after listening to the school department's budget the other day, just for vocational school, as you cited earlier on with Mr. Seibach,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's $19,000 a year to send a child from Hadley to Smith School.
Yeah.
You know, that's a lot of money over and above what we allow and for our students.
It's college tuition.
Yeah.
You seriously?
It's, John said $10,000 for that Chapter 70 money, and you're at $11,200. Mm-hmm. So you're pretty much right on the money there with that. That particular figures.
Yeah, in my travels in looking at fire stations throughout Western Mass and beyond, what I found here, and Donald was with me, a lot of these fire departments today, when they hire someone, say for hiring, it's slash fireman. So the benefits come out of their full-time job at the DPW, but when there's an alarm, there's like a full-time fireman. They got a response. I feel big on that, and other communities do that. And if you're replacing basically Stanley was DPW slash fireman, Amherst firefighter slash EMT, and they're doing that, and they're just enhancing, you know, not just one department, but another one that's really slacking is the fire department. So I would hope you guys would look into that.
Utilizing all our resources in town.
Yeah, right.
Especially during the day. That's the biggest issue. I mean,
during the day.
Three or four of us, if there's a real fire or a real bad accident, then there's three or four of us that do leave the DPW.
But today you've got a big package in benefits.
Yeah.
So his full-time job would be the DPW, but if there's an alarm, he's to go in. Remember, we were there in Zarefield. There was like 8 of them came from the DPW. Boom, right in there.
Yeah.
You know, Yankee Candle used to supply 2 on-shift people that were responders.
Yeah.
And as soon as the fire alarm went off, they would go out regardless of what they were doing.
We did the same thing, Jerry, on the dive team. Every place where people, we had toners from the county.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, it saves a lot of money.
We need to think outside the box here. One of the other things that I'm very, very concerned with, and this is adding full-time people, is the fact that our it's become a, you know, firemen have made this impossible to do. Now there's so much training and so much this and so much that. People who used to go to fires to save people's houses and towns, who threw on the suits and got out there and did the best thing that they could, now we're telling those people that they're no good to us anymore. Unless you are, you know, 100% fire trained, and unless you know everything about it, then we're not letting you on our trucks. And the problem with that, and it's safer, I understand it's safer. The problem is that the amount of people now that you have to draw from that are volunteers and that want to be volunteers is dwindling to the point where you go from 22 to 11, and now we're going to add some full-timers during the day. And does that just all of a sudden, are we going to have no more volunteers? Because that's my fear, is that our volunteers are going to disappear.
What stops that, Jerry, is what happened like in 9/11. Parents don't want their kids responding to them, and they're never going to see them again. It's getting to be hazardous. They're getting to be dangerous.
That's
where the training comes in, to save lives and to be careful.
Yeah, but it was long before 9/11 that this took place, that you had to go to the fire station, get on the truck and go, where years ago you just went.
Jumped in your car.
The overall, when firemen died, that's just a bad taste in a lot of mommies' mouths.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they don't want to see their
kids
die.
Well, I don't think it's just mothers. I don't think anybody wants to see people die.
No. Town of Sunderland has an incentive program where they actually pay the firefighters for a shift. So if you're home, if you're a night person that works at night, and you're home and you're an on-call person, they'll pay them $40 a day to be at home. They still get paid to go out to the fire, but they're home and they're an on-call person waiting for the alarm.
For
it's a stipend for the shift.
Yeah.
So if the alarm goes off, they're the people that are going. And you know that if you have three of those people at home and you're paying $40 a shift to have them there, these people are going to respond and they're out and available. You're not. Yeah. And I'm not saying that's the answer either. I know Michael's got a tremendous problem on his hands. It's just, you're adding four people, and I think if you sent that out to the taxpayers and asked them to vote on it, I don't know if it's necessarily fair to our fire department to not help support them. So I mean, we have to help do things to, maybe we get two of them this year, maybe we try for four next year, or you know, we got to look at funding. So people have brought up before whether or not we need to split the tax rate, because so much of this is being, you know, has to do with the businesses that are on Route 9.
Well, I think David's already kind of started that process of reaching out to the folks who are looking for enhanced services. Right, David?
Mm-hmm.
That you've gone back and said, look, at, you know, it's not looking like we're going to do this, so what can we do here?
Yeah, well,
some of them are involved with the Business Bureau in Amherst, the local Business Bureau in Amherst, too, some of the bigger businesses, I believe, aren't they?
You're talking about the Amherst Area Chamber?
Yeah, Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about it?
Well, I mean, the businesses should have a little bit of input on our decision also, you know. On top of the taxation we got on the food meals tax and everything, you know, some of those big boxes could move out. You don't know if you put too much of a strain on them.
Businesses don't have an impact on your own. Out-of-town businesses don't have an impact on local economies, and there's a reason for that. I'm talking about if you split the rate and you added a dollar to the business tax, if you determine that a business tax. I'm not talking about doubling it. I'm just saying if there's going to be a responsibility there and we need to think outside the box to try to finance this particular thing and we can justify it, and I think maybe it's time that we start looking at things like this. I absolutely agree.
But we
and
do
that's
it,
what I'm saying. I'd like to see a little input.
We've already talked about it, yeah.
I'd like to see a little input from the businesses.
True.
You know, okay, it'd be very difficult to do highway personnel / firemen because of union contracts, first of all. You know, but the thing for the future is firemen / ETM, our ambulance
EMTs,
service,
yeah.
Which is a moneymaker. Everywhere where I travel, they're using the ambulance service to augment fire department budgets.
We've been saying
I think the point being, everybody's agreeing that we need to think outside the box if we're going to go back to the tax, especially if we're going back to the taxpayers to ask for more money. And I agree with you. I think people, they want all the facts.
We just lucked in right now with all nine passing, which has never been done in Hadley before. So, you know, count their blessings.
And nobody's anywhere
right
near
now.
Done. You've got a library coming behind it. You've got a
that's right.
DPW building that's looking for an enhancement. I mean,
that's right.
Also, can I ask one more question? Is that we're talking about adding money to the stabilization fund here. I'm not tremendously in favor of that, and I know that I'm coming in on the 11th hour with that. I'd rather look at offsetting some of our, even if it goes towards the OPM, I don't think our stabilization needs any more of an influx of money. I think we have plenty of money in our stabilization fund.
Well, David's just presenting this. I mean, we haven't even...
Set forth as one of our goals, and I'm guessing that David didn't invent that, that it came from this board.
Yes, we talked about replenishing the money that was taken out.
Well, my point would be,
my theories are we're over 2 million. I think 5,000 can go someplace else very nicely, but I think that's for further discussion.
Okay.
And the other side of the issue is 2 million is nothing. We get a major infrastructure failure.
That's why they have SRFs.
Looks like we're going to have a robust discussion on the 15th. Any questions, send them to David between now and then.
Thanks for the budget.
Yeah. Well, thank you for all of the work.
You thought I meant that.
We got until July 1st to read this?
Yeah, seriously. Okay, so that was our last agenda item for the evening. Do we have announcements?
I have a couple.
Okay.
Jessica Spankenable has asked if we would read that there are 2 school committee appointments open for the elections for this April. There are 1 housing authority, and no one has taken out papers for school committee yet. So papers are available now. Housing authority, there's 1 position and open. No one has taken out any. And the library trustees, there's 2 positions available. Only 1 person has taken out nomination papers for that position. So if anybody feels interested in volunteering, they'd love to have you come out and take some papers and get involved in your school and community.
And if you're even thinking about it and you're not sure, feel free to reach out to people who've held the positions before so that they can tell you what it's really like. Mm-hmm. But it's, again, don't speculate.
Yeah.
No, well, no.
There's nobody applying for it now.
No, no. Doesn't have to be scary.
The housing authority, the state appointee, Glenn Clark, or is it someone else?
I don't know. Do you know?
Did not.
Because he told me that he's not going to get involved anymore.
Hmm.
You know, he's going to walk away from everything,
yeah.
Even the Council on Aging. He got it to this point, and he's not going to stay.
Sure.
He's like 93, so he's served this town a long time.
He did.
You know.
What, John?
The Dyke information, the 5 pages, can we get that online?
The
for the public?
Proposal?
Yeah.
You mean post it?
Yeah, post it.
It is on
the website. There's a lot of people on West Street, East Street. I mean,
he means on the website?
Yeah, just on a website, not on TV5.
But it's already there. You go into Board Docs and it's there. It's not that's not a locked document.
How would they know to go there?
Yeah,
the point, if they don't go to Board Docs, why can't we be somewhere where visibly you go online and say.
That was the other thing. It takes quite a bit to
maneuver.
Understand how to get into Board Docs through the select board meeting. And then we're on the bottom of the list to begin with anyway. So, you know, you got to, there's a couple channels to go through to get this information.
Joyce, you have more announcements?
I did. We just want to send our sympathies to the family of Adeline Melnick, to the families of William Howes, and to the family of Marilyn Judah. That also includes for Marilyn. She was one of our school teachers. She had many friends here in Hadley and students that she had taught over the years. So our condolences to everybody who knew her.
Anything else tonight, folks?
Like to say thanks to everybody that was involved with the cornhole tournament last weekend. That's the American Legion, Peter Benben, Tom Witkus, Richie Witkus, and Tommy Washkevitz. Made some good money for Fragile X Syndrome, and we really appreciate everybody's help and support. Thank you.
John?
Could I get a copy of David's financial report?
The budget?
The budget.
Public record.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
Sure.
So, okay. Did you have that?
I will not have it tonight, but I will have it.
No.
Okay.
Right here.
Okay. Okay. Motion made and seconded to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.